presented a few thoughts that were discussed in the last EPI working group meeting that are important concepts while developing the national cholera control plans. So the presentation will be around the concept of hotspots, the concept of control, and cholera elimination. So if we simplify a lot the different epidemiological profiles that we can find in the world, we can describe at least two major type of settings where cholera is present. The first one are countries that have an epidemic cholera. These are areas that suffer the occurrence of sporadic outbreaks, usually associated with high morbidity and mortality. And we have very clear examples of this type of epidemiological profiles, like it was the case in Angola in 2006, Zimbabwe 2008 and 9, Haiti 2010, or Yemen recently in 2017. So we have this first profile. And then we have a second profile where cholera is present most of the time, are areas with high incidence of cholera in a persistent manner. And we have some countries that are clearly endemic, like India, Bangladesh, or DRC in Africa. But these concepts, we have other countries that are in an intermediate situation where they have some areas with endemic cholera, while other areas might suffer outbreaks. And actually, when we try to apply these concepts at country level, we can differentiate within the country this type of epidemiological profiles. A very nice exercise looking at these different type of profiles has been done in DRC, in Congo, and the Ministry of Health of Congo has extensively studied these concepts since many years ago and has a very clear classification of areas that are highly endemic and where cholera is persistent, they're called sans sanctuaire for the cholera, and there are other areas that are prone to outbreaks, like Kinshasa or several areas around the Congo River. So you see that this concept of epidemic cholera and endemic cholera can be as well retrieved at country level. So when we look at the WHO cholera roadmap, there is a concept that is extremely important inside, that is the concept of hotspots. Many of the concepts that are included in the roadmap claim to focus the effort, the multisectorial intervention in hotspots. The Ministry of Health of DRC has clearly identified their hotspots, and most of them are in the eastern part of the country around the lakes. And then, however, this exercise that needs to be done is not fully standardized. So one of the things that we did in the last EPI working group meeting was try to discuss a common methodology that could be applied in the different countries to identify these hotspots. We have a hotspot definition in the interim guidance of surveillance that was discussed but not reviewed in the last EPI working group meeting. And we know that it might have some problems in terms of specificity. And many of the working group members found that this definition is not sufficient at all to be operational and pragmatic. It's not enough in order to identify areas where we want to focus interventions. So for the moment, we have decided not to change the definition, but what we're discussing in the last working group meeting was a whole process to identify these areas. So trying to be pragmatic about providing guidance to the countries on how to conduct a hotspot mapping. The first important thing to mention is that we should subscribe the identification of cholera hotspot in a larger framework that is a situation analysis that should be conducted to develop national cholera control plans. Specifically, we discuss the concept of cholera burden hotspots. There's different type of hotspots, transmission hotspots, amplification hotspots. And we wanted to remain with this concept of cholera burden hotspot, meaning areas with high incidence of cholera in the past. An important concept that was discussed as well is that the hotspots, areas with high and persistent cholera in a country, are just a subset of the areas that are at risk. So there might be other areas with no cholera or little cholera that might present conditions that are favorable for a spread, and these areas should as well be targeted in the national cholera control plans. This is why it's important that in addition to the hotspot mapping, there is additional factors, contextual factors, for instance, vulnerability criteria, like the presence of displaced populations, amplification criteria, like urban hubs that can be important for transmission, or cultural or behavioral criteria, like presence of nomadic or mobile populations, that might justify that even if there are places where there's no cholera, they might be targeted for interventions as part of the national cholera control plans. In addition, of course, we need to look at the WASH indicators to refine the situational analysis. And what was proposed is to keep the same SDG criteria as main indicators to complete a situational analysis as part of the cholera situational analysis to develop the national cholera control plans. As I mentioned the first day, this should be a dynamic process. We might have a baseline that should be updated over time to make sure that we trace the evolution of these hotspots. So I'm just going to focus briefly and try to describe what has been proposed to countries in order to develop a hotspot analysis as part of the situational analysis for the development of the national cholera control plans. It was agreed in the last working group meeting that the source of information should be country data on cholera suspected cases. We know that many countries have problems to have good lab data, and what will be the common denominator for all countries will be the IDSR surveillance and the routine surveillance on cholera suspected cases. It was agreed as well that the main indicator to conduct the burden hotspot analysis will be the mean annual incidence, and the recommended period of analysis was 5 years. There was a long discussion about additional periods that could be considered, and as well was agreed that sensitivity analysis could be considered in a window for 3 to 10 years. The recommended administrative area level is a level 2 area, district level, and we describe a very simple procedure. So the recommendation was that the countries will be ranking the cholera districts in terms of mean annual incidence. Then we will calculate a second criteria that will be the persistence of cholera in those districts as a percentage of months or weeks, depending on the availability of the data, with reported cholera over the period of analysis. And then in a third step, we will plot the mean annual incidence versus the persistence to try to classify these areas of high incidence between those that are have persistent cholera versus those that don't have persistent cholera. Then in a fourth step, this rank might be revised considering other factors like the case fatality risk, or if the laboratory data is available, the presence of lab confirmed tested at district level. So just to give you an example about how this hotspot mapping is expected to be conducted in the future, you see in the left side of the slide, the rank of districts in terms of mean annual cholera incidence. Here is presented as cholera suspected cases per 1,000 people. And in the right side, you have the same distribution of the districts, but with the addition of the second criteria, that is the persistence. So basically, in this upper part of the plot, you'll have all the areas that have shown a high incidence in the past, but we will be able to classify those areas in terms of persistence. So we'll have one group of districts that will have high incidence and high persistence, and this will be the hotspots, those areas that should be prioritized in the national cholera control plans. We have a second group that will have high incidence but low persistence, meaning that there is variability from one year to another. There will be places prone to epidemics and should be considered as a medium high risk as part of the national cholera control plans. Then we have places with low incidence but persistent, so a stable low incidence. It will be the third group of districts, and those with the lowest priority will be those with low incidence and low persistence. So this will be will provide a clear framework for the countries to conduct hotspot identification. And I said before, there might be other areas that are not included as part of the districts presenting cholera in the past few years, and that might be included in the national cholera control plans if they are justified considering contextual factors or wash conditions that are really poor. So that's the first part related with how we are proposing that the hotspot mapping is implemented. Then a second discussion that took place in the last EPI working group meeting that is very important for many countries right now is whether we are going to be able to certify elimination at country level. Well, the first thing that is important to say is that actually it's possible, whether it's possible or not to eliminate cholera. And what is clear is that even if we had not been able to eliminate cholera in the world, at least many countries have eliminated cholera right now as a public health problem. In the prior pandemics, Europe and North America were highly touched by cholera, but it's not the case in the context of the same pandemic. In the context of the same pandemic, cholera has not been a problem in Europe or in North America, despite of regular introductions. And this is not a minor thing. Every year, there is travelers that are coming to France, Switzerland, carrying cholera. I was discussing this morning with Marie-Laure that a new suspected case detected in France yesterday. So this happened often, but the conditions are not conducive for transmission, so there is no spread. And if there would be a spread, probably the outbreak will be contained quickly. So actually, this means that even if the risk of introduction cannot be completely eliminated, the risk of a spread can be eliminated. I think that the other important example that we have is actually the Americas. The seventh pandemic arrived to Latin America in the 90s, and after several years of outbreaks in different countries, cholera has been eliminated right now as a public health problem in South and Central America, keeping Haiti as the only country reporting cholera in this part of the world. So we have proved, again, even in the context of the same pandemic, that cholera can be eliminated as a public health problem. Now, the big question comes for countries that have had a lot of cholera in the past recent years, like Haiti or like South Sudan, but that they are reaching currently control. Haiti is very close to have the outbreak control. South Sudan is not reporting cholera since 2017. So the big question is how we are going to establish criteria to certify elimination in countries that are achieving control. And this is not a minor issue for countries that are making big efforts to have cholera eliminated as a public health problem. So this concept was discussed as well in the last EPI working group meeting. And again, there is a definition that is included in the interim guidance of cholera surveillance. There's three important concepts. The first one is that, in the definition, the first one is that the country should be reporting absence of cholera. For countries that do not report absence of cholera, they cannot claim elimination. And as well that the absence of confirmed cholera cases is cases that are not result of local transmission. So if there is an introduction, this cannot be This will be not enough to claim that a country has not eliminated cholera. This is the example that I just gave from France or from any other country that received imported cholera. Then the window that is considered in the definition are 3 years, and this was hotly debated in the working group, and we decided not to touch this window because either a shorter window, a longer window can be justified, but we consider that this is coherent with other programs that have established similar criteria to certify the elimination, and this is an example, for instance, for measles. So just for consistency with other diseases, we decided not to change this window. And the third aspect that is extremely important is that the surveillance system should be strong enough to detect presence of cholera and confirm cholera if cholera arises. So what the group agreed is that even if we don't touch the definition, what is important is to develop a process to certify elimination. How we are going to make sure that a country that claims that don't have cholera anymore is not going to have cholera can certify that elimination has been reached. So the working group aimed for this year to develop a draft of a certification process, and there will be two criteria that will be very important. First, that the country has a validated national cholera control plan, and second, a well-functioning surveillance system. Then other criteria that were discussed were the capacity to mitigate the risk following introductions, and what will be very difficult is to agree on what we consider that that's sufficient standards to remove the risk of a spread. Other performance indicators were well discussed, like the number of cholera alerts investigated per year. So I think that it will be a very important task for the year, and we wanted just to share these thoughts with the larger group in the annual meeting. Thank you very much.